Coronavirus isn't dangerous for me, so I'm not worried. And besides, the chance that I'll actually get it is basically zero. These are two of the most common reasons I hear for why someone is not worried about COVID-19 and why they're not doing much about it. I want to explain in this video why they make no sense and why staying at home is an effective thing that you can do to stop the spread of this virus and why you should. Okay, so quick interruption. I finished filming this just before I heard the news that the USA government now recommends that no more than 10 people meet at the same place, which I think is excellent news and I'm super relieved to hear it. So I really hope other countries follow suit, and the rest of this video is going to explain why I think you should follow this advice, whether you're in America or not. It is true that if you're young and healthy, that your own chance of death from this disease are very low. But let's say that you were to get sick. At the current rate, you're likely to spread it to 2 to 3 other people. Other people that you're in contact with, all healthy too. Perhaps they are, but remember, each of them will spread it to 2 to 3 more people, and they each spread it to 2 to 3 themselves, and so on. There are going to be vulnerable people fairly close to you that the virus reaches directly because you got sick. An elderly person, someone with diabetes, someone with chronic respiratory problems. For me, this would be my grandma, my dad, and my cousin. And looking at these death probabilities makes it real for me. And remember, each of the people you might spread the virus to has their own people to be worrying about as well. If you reduce the number of people you infect, even though you might not see it, this has a huge positive ripple-on effect. You are directly responsible for the lives of people, some you know, many who you don't. But maybe you think that you're not likely to get this disease. After all, in the US right now, there's only a few thousand cases compared to a population of a few hundred million. And so, yeah, right now your probability is very low. But it's changing fast. I mean, even a week ago, this whole thing felt a lot less serious, right? And honestly, I was very surprised by this too until I stopped and did this little calculation. See, you've probably heard the number of cases being reported daily in the news, but that's not what's important. What's important is the answer to this question. How many days would it take for the number of cases in your country to go up by a factor of 10? So to get 10 times bigger. For example, there are roughly 5,000 cases in the US right now, but how much longer until you have 50,000 cases? A couple of months maybe, a few weeks? That's not it. If things keep going in the same trend as they have been in the USA right now, then the number of cases goes up by a factor of 10 in just 1 week. So if nothing were to change, next week it's 50,000, more than the number in Italy right now. In 2 weeks it would be 500,000, and in just 3 weeks, it would be 5 million. It's a similar rate of growth in all the other countries that haven't yet taken drastic measures like lockdowns. If you remember no other statistic from this video, just remember this. If we don't take drastic actions, then this problem gets 10 times worse in 1 week, every week. If people are still allowed to go outside freely, for example, like in these countries right now, and this is roughly the number of cases there are at the moment, next week you will have 10 times that, and again the week after, and again. But it doesn't need to be like this. Our main focus should be on increasing this time from a week to a lot longer so that the spread is slower. For example, Italy was, until its lockdown, at a similar rate, 10 times worse in 1 week, but has now slowed that time to about 17 days. We have to accept that this disease is probably still going to spread very widely, but we need to make that spread go in as slow motion as we can manage. That might sound like a stupid idea. I mean, why drag out the inevitable? Well, hopefully you've seen this brilliant infographic from Dr. Susie Wiles that explains it. If the number of cases keeps rising this fast, we will have a lot of cases all at once and suddenly. There'll be way more sick people than hospitals can treat at once. For example, in the USA, there's only about 350,000 beds for coronavirus patients, which is nowhere near enough. if this virus is going to keep spreading at the rate it is now. Hospitals will be swamped. Once that happens, doctors will start having to make decisions about who will live because not everyone can be cared for. On the other hand, if we can seriously slow the spread of this disease, then there may be enough healthcare to go around. This isn't just hypothetical either. You might have heard that the death rate of COVID-19 is less than 1%, but that's in places where everyone can still get treatment. In places that have been overwhelmed, the death rate is more like 3 to 5%, but it could become even higher if a healthcare system is truly overworked. This is why we need to slow it down, because we don't want to be in the position where 1 in every 20 people who get this disease will die, not because they had to, but because we didn't have the resources to save them. So how can we slow the spread? Here's a useful simulation from the Washington Post that explains it. Here the blue dots represent healthy people, but the brown dots represent people with the virus. When an infected person comes into contact with someone else, they will spread the virus to them. When a person with the virus recovers, they become purple to show that they can no longer infect or be infected. Let's see what happens when everyone is allowed to mingle freely, like they still are in a lot of places. As you can see, very, very quickly, there is a huge number of people sick at the same time. This is when hospitals will be jammed and doctors are working until they collapse or get ill. So how can we slow this down? Well, what if we ask everyone to stay home if they can? Limit contact with others as much as possible. Let's simulate this by getting most of these dots to stop moving to represent people staying at home. There will still be some people who can't, for example, because they just can't work from home. These people are still moving and able to spread the disease, but see how slow that spread is now. There's way fewer people who are sick at the same time. There are two main reasons that staying at home like this works. The first is that your probability of getting sick is now so much lower because you're much less likely to meet someone who's infected. But also, you're much less likely to spread the disease even if you were to get sick because you're not meeting as many people. This is called social distancing and it saves lives. Companies can save lives by asking employees to work from home if possible. Universities and schools can save lives by having classes remotely or simply shutting down. Religious leaders can save lives by asking their congregation to pray from home rather than gathering. Event organizers can save lives by cancelling matches and festivals. And governments can save lives by making all of this mandatory. And you can save lives too by avoiding non-essential gatherings, even things like going to dinner with friends. Especially if you have the main symptoms of this disease, which are a fever and a dry cough, you can save lives by isolating yourself. But just to be clear, you should be staying home even if you're not sick. That's because over 20% of the infections come from people without any symptoms yet. From people who think that they're fine and so they continue to go about their lives, meeting others and inadvertently making them sick as well. These are all the reasons that social distancing makes sense, but I know it's tough and you're probably thinking that you're going to go crazy. But there are a few things that you can do to make it a little bit easier. The first is call your family and your friends and your colleagues for no reason at all, just to chat. For example, the place where I'm about to start a job is now completely working from home, but every lunchtime they video call each other so that they can share a meal together virtually. It's super important to make sure that you're talking to people at least once a day, so call your friends. Secondly, look after your physical health as well. You only need to be avoiding people, not sunlight. So in most places, you can still go outside for a walk.
Kara, do you want to go for a walk? Do you want to go for a walk?
Lastly, try keep yourself productively occupied in your newfound spare time. There's only so many movies that you can watch before you feel frustrated that you're not doing anything. So maybe take this as your chance to learn that thing that you've been wanting to learn, or to read more, or to finish one of your projects. The point is this though, staying inside saves lives, so thank you for doing this for other people. But remember to look after yourself as well. Just make sure you don't go crazy. Good luck.